It's the Games and Graps Podcast. This week, we discuss Resident Evil 7 and give our predictions for NXT TakeOver San Antonio, as well as this Sunday's Royal Rumble.
What's up, guys? Welcome to episode 49 of the Games and Graps Podcast. I'm Sonny, and I'm one of your hosts, and with me, as always, is Finn Steele.
Hello.
How you doing?
I'm very good, thank you. How are you?
I'm good, but I would be better if we didn't have so many technical issues today doing this bloody podcast.
I know. It's like third attempts. Well, like 27th attempt.
Yeah. We've been trying this for an hour now. We've had some technical issues with the MacBook that we use, and they are all fixed now.
Yay.
Then it's just general idiot errors on our part.
Yeah.
But hopefully this time we can get a decent run and actually get this thing recorded for your listening pleasure.
Yeah.
Finn.
Yeah.
What have you been playing this week?
Well, I'm playing a brand new Resident Evil 7. Yeah.
Finally, it's here.
It's here. Playing it in VR as well, which is extra good. And I love it. So far, it's been excellent. I've played about maybe 2 hours now and a half, maybe. And yeah, I loved it. It's the most Resident Evil feeling game since, like, Resident Evil 3.
Yes.
It's got save rooms, it's got item boxes, the saving music. It's all there. All the classic Resident Evil tropes. And I loved it a bit, yeah. It's so good. It's the Resident Evil game I wanted, but didn't know I wanted.
I understand what you mean.
Yeah.
I feel the same. I really like it.
Yeah.
I think it's not the game that people were maybe expecting from the beginning hour demo.
Yeah.
But I think that's a good thing. It has to still be Resident Evil, and it is. The beginning hour demo would have you believe that the game is like a puzzle solving, figuring out where things are, where things should go type game.
Makes it feel more like an Outlast or a PT or something.
Yeah, with very little combat.
Yeah.
But, you know, the beginning hour stuff is in the beginning of the game.
Mm-hmm.
It's changed around a little bit, but nothing too dramatic. But once you get past that, it does become action-y. And to me, it is an action game. To me, it's Resident Evil in first person.
Yeah.
And I think that's what it needed to be.
Yeah, that's the third person perspective. It just moves from like a fixed camera angle to first person, basically.
Yeah.
Feels like a classic PS1 Resident Evil.
But it really works, and it makes Resident Evil feel fresh, and it hasn't felt fresh maybe since Resident Evil 4.
Yeah,
because obviously 5 was fine, but it was an action adventure game.
It wasn't
Resident Evil 1 or 2 or even 3. And 6 is ridiculous.
It's
such a bad game, and it needed a break from the numbered Resident Evil games. And they've gone away, they've taken a new approach to it, and Resident Evil 7 Biohazard is here, and it's fresh, and the first person really works, and it's just a fantastic game. So I really do recommend it.
Yes.
Go in with an open mind, not what you think you're going to get from the beginning hour demo, because it is different to that.
Yeah, a lot of people were saying, oh, they've ruined Resident Evil, oh, first person, no, that's rubbish. But it really is Resident Evil. It is a Resident Evil game, through and through. Also, in VR, it's excellent as well. Once he's spent a lot of time making VR work and feel comfortable. If you have a place in VR, just sitting there gathering dust, I highly recommend trying it out.
Yeah.
It's not too scary. It's not overly scary. It will make you jump, of course.
It relies on scripted jump scares.
Yeah.
It isn't scary. I think the tension is what gets you.
Yeah, for sure. The feeling of being chased. When you feel like someone's chasing you from behind, it's like, whoa, God. You like, look behind you, it's like, oh, God, it's chasing me.
Yeah, I imagine that's that more cool. So in VR than it is sort of playing it.
You're probably,
normally.
Yeah. Yeah.
There's a couple of things that I think they could fix. Like when you, I know this is a very common first person thing, but like there's blood splatter on the screen when you get injured. I don't really like that, and I think it takes a sense of immersion away.
Okay.
Because I don't like that. I think there could have been a better way to handle it. Don't get me wrong. I don't have an answer.
I think you might turn it off, actually. I think there's an option for it in the options.
You can't turn it off. You can either have normal or light.
Oh, okay.
So there's no option to turn it off. Be awesome if they patched it in so you can have it off.
Hmm.
but I feel like they should have maybe found a way to do it better anyway.
Yeah.
But you can't blame them for going down the if it ain't broke, don't fix it type FPS route.
Yeah, seriously.
So, you know, it's a very minor thing. There isn't many bad things about the game at all.
No, no.
A few frame rate drops, a couple of fading in graphics.
Oh, yeah. But, I didn't notice, actually, when I looked around the corner in VR, like some of the next day I hadn't loaded yet. It's like, take a step forward. It's like, okay, now there it is.
Yeah.
Pops in.
Like at the beginning of the game when you're driving in.
Oh, yeah,
like
yeah.
The trees were like, well, it was just, to be honest, it was just like,
it's like 2D images.
a mix of moldy green out the car window. It's like, where the hell am I? Am
yeah.
I just in swamp water? And then you get out the car and the trees are like, just they look amazing. And it's
great,
like,
yeah.
Oh, it's just silly little things that let games down. But other than that, and those, you know, very, very tiny things that you could point out, it's a very good game.
Yes.
I'm going to play through it more. I'm going to play through it until I beat it, and then I'm going to move on to something else. Because I don't want to come out of it to have to go back into it, if you understand what I mean.
That makes sense.
Because like, I do it all the time. Like, I play some of games, and I'm like, yeah, I'll just go back to it eventually. But with this, I like the story, and it had me gripped last night. I must have played like 3 hours or so.
Nice.
And without even realising.
Yeah, yeah.
So I think that's how you know it's a good game.
Absolutely. Good stuff.
I don't think it's 10 out of 10.
Okay.
Based on what I've played so far, I would say it's a high 8.
Okay. I need to play more before I make my decision. But yeah, it's good stuff.
Very, 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 very good game.
Very good. They got can't speak. Classic with evil puzzles as well. Like,
yes.
Gather three dog heads to open this door.
Yeah. Get half a bull statue to get into the main hall. And it has all the Resident Evil things that you love and that are absolutely ridiculous. Like, only in Resident Evil would you need a half a bull to get into a door.
Yeah. Makes no sense, but it's amazing.
Yeah, but you just accept it because it's like, well, it's Resident Evil, I guess. So
yeah, I guess that makes sense. Yeah,
yeah.
Go around gathering the things. Yeah,
yeah. I wish my house had a bull lock.
Yeah, it's like, all I'm gonna do is take this grandfather's lock pendulum and put it into this other grandfather's lock, and that gives me one of the dog heads. Of course, that's how it works.
I want secret rooms where I have to turn things. I turn.
Yeah, line up the shadow.
Line up the shadow with the animal. Of course, I want that.
Yeah, well, yeah.
But yeah, it's a great game.
It's so good.
Finn, how are you enjoying Ollie Ollie 2?
I
know. I think you're going to enjoy it less because of the task I set you.
Yes.
So if you don't know, me and Finn had bets on this podcast last year. We were about to start them again today.
Mm-hmm.
And Finn lost, basically. Finn lost the bets throughout the course of the year thanks to WWE 2K17 and Garbage Mechanics.
Tie. Yeah, it was a tie at the end of the year, and then we had a fight in 2K17. Yeah. Of course, the game is garbage. I got screwed over and suddenly won.
Yeah.
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 So now I'm tasked with platinuming Ollie Ollie 2.
Which is a thankless task.
It's so difficult.
I mean, I love the game. I mean, I've had it since it came out, and I think it was free, actually.
Cool.
When it first came out, maybe. Or maybe that was the first one. I can't quite remember. Either way.
Maybe. Can't remember.
I love the game, but I don't play it with these sole aim of getting the platinum, so I just play it for leisure.
Yeah.
Obviously, you've got this task.
Yes.
How are you finding it?
Well, I've beaten, quote-unquote, amateur Drax, or amateur Drax. Haven't done all the objectives, obviously, because they're friggin' impossible. But yeah, it's a good game, for the most part, with frustrating controls. Mm. To me, I feel like the controls the timing required is way too precise. Because I feel myself just doing the same things over and over and over again, hitting things exactly the same, and sometimes they'll work, sometimes they won't. And to me, that's a sign of that your controls aren't great. If the person playing it feels like they're doing the same thing, but getting different results every time, that doesn't feel right.
I think it is incredibly precise, especially with the landings and the rotation of the sticks needed for some of the tricks, which I will say is very difficult.
Yeah.
Because especially when it asks you to combine tricks together,
yes.
That's when the game for me gets very hard. And that's why I don't play it with that intention of getting the platinum, because I know that it is just so fucking difficult.
Yeah.
You think two is bad, one is worse.
Really?
Because you don't have manual in one.
Oh, really?
And it's just not as smooth. So
yeah.
Chaining combos together in the first game is It's very, very difficult.
God.
I love the music. I love the atmosphere. I love the cool graphics. I love the way the controls are supposed to work.
When they do work.
I mean, I am good at it. But that's from me playing it casually and just getting to grips with it. And when I play it now, I can do everything with very...
Yeah.
I mean, with very little error.
Yeah. I mean, I can do most things. It's just the objectives. It's like, on the last level, you have to do like 30 spins.
Yeah, it's ridiculous.
Sounds easy, but isn't. And yeah. I got into a routine of doing it, and I did finally got like a perfect run out of it, and I still didn't get 30 spins. Like, I don't know how I could have done any better than I did.
There's very little room for error in those last levels as well. I mean, yeah, it's difficult enough to actually get through
to beat
the game on amateur.
Yeah.
I mean, the pro levels are hard, and of course, you have to get 5 stars on every amateur level to unlock all of the pro levels.
Yep.
Yeah, it's a thankless game, it is.
It is. It's so hard.
But it is a good game. I think... If you're playing it for sport, like I do, I think you'd actually really enjoy it.
Probably. But yeah, I am going to try and platinum it.
If you can't...
It's probably going to take me all year to do it, if I can.
Yeah. I think I've set you a thankless task. So if I lose the best this year, I deserve a real piece of shit task to do.
Yeah. Okay. I think it's going to be good.
Although Persona would have taken me like 60 hours to finish anyway.
Probably. But it'd have been good 60 hours.
Yeah, I mean, Ollie Ollies are good. It's fun for 8 hours.
It's fun for like 20 minutes.
I love it. I really do love it. And that's why I wanted you to play it. But I wish I had just said, just play Ollie Ollie. Just buy it. Spend £8, play Ollie Ollie. It's great.
But I'll do it. I'm a man of my word and I will try my best.
Okay. What else have you been playing?
I also played the Neo Last Chance Trial. I released another demo for it, which is very good. I streamed it, in fact. If you want to see me suffer my way through that, you can. I say suffer, it's not a bad game, I love it, it's great. It's very difficult, especially the end boss. It took me many, many, many attempts.
Man, I was watching that, and I just could not believe the torture you went through.
I know, speaking of precise timing, the timing required to like dodge like the boss's attacks was very precise. But, unlike on the LE2, I could feel myself getting better and better every time. And eventually I was able to beat it, and I felt great doing so. It's a really good game. I'm going to buy it for sure.
It is that Dark Souls thing of, okay, I know what I've got to do.
Yeah.
It's now just putting it into action.
Absolutely.
Dark Souls, Bloodborne, Neo, they are very, I mean, they're similar. They're basically...
They're the same type of game, yeah.
They're the same type of game.
For sure.
I played it. I thought it was quite difficult, but I wasn't really concentrating on it. It was more of a, right, I'm going to see what this is like. And I knew what to expect, sort of having played Dark Souls and Bloodborne. But I think it's great. I love the setting. I think the setting's fantastic.
Yeah.
I really do.
It's very cool.
It's one I might look at getting at some point down the line, but cool. I'm not in a hurry to sort of day one it.
Cool. Well, to be fair, if I get it, you'll have it anyway, so.
Fair enough. That's a good point, yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, that's what I'm going to...
The wonder of sharing profiles on both PlayStation and Xbox.
Absolutely.
Good
yes.
times.
Good times. And I think that's about it. More Overwatch, obviously. More Final Fantasy. And all that good stuff.
Cool.
How about you?
I've been playing... I played about 4 hours of Battlefield 1 on Sunday.
Yeah, nice.
Me and Denzel hopped into multiplayer.
Oh, yeah.
And you know what? I'm really enjoying it. And I don't suck at it either.
Nice.
So that's nice. A real bonus.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like it a lot. God, the graphics are just so incredible. It is... Like, you're playing it and you're like, God, the war would have really sucked. Like,
man, this would have been sucked if I'd been... Have yeah. Brothers fly past me and...
I'd be dead so quickly. But no. Joking aside, it's a very, very good game. We were playing sort of Capture the Flag on various different maps, and I just love the way that you can basically approach it however you want.
Cool.
Different classes, there's vehicles and stuff. It's crazy, but I think it's very good. And I do highly recommend it. I never thought I'd play it and enjoy it multiplayer. But, which is classic me, because I usually buy Call of Duty and like, looking forward to playing the campaign, never play it, and just play multiplayer until the next one comes out. So, yeah. And I think that's probably what it's going to be like with Battlefield. I've been playing that, and I've been playing Yakuza 0.
Ooh, nice.
Man, I've been so excited for it.
Yeah, it's so good.
And I played through Chapter 1.
Really good reviews as well.
Yeah, really good reviews. Play through Chapter 1, which the chapters are long, because it's very talky.
Yeah, as the odds are.
Yeah. It's in Japanese with English subs. Well, and I'm fine with it because I think it adds to the atmosphere.
Yeah, for sure. First one had English dubs, which just sounded off and weird.
It's like when you watch a foreign film and it's got English dubs
exactly
over
yeah.
the top of it. And it's like, nah, this sucks.
Yeah,
but it's a really good game. It's like Shenmue and Sleeping Dogs.
Yeah,
and
it's very Shenmue.
All those sort of things. Yeah, it is very Shenmue-esque.
Yeah,
just it just looks like Shenmue, and the fighting's great. It's very arcadey and doesn't take itself seriously at all.
I love the fighting.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. It's like, it's so outrageous. If you're going in expecting like the story is super serious,
yeah,
and then you get out there in the streets and you're just walloping people all over the place. You can pick bins and crap up. You can. It's just so crazy. But it's so cool. I love that there's different things to do. Like, I went to a batting cage.
Oh yeah.
And did like a batting cage mini game, which was nice. Bloody difficult.
Yeah.
Went into the Sega arcade and had a quick go on Space Harrier.
Nice. That's very similar as well. Space Harriers.
Yeah.
Cool.
But it's very cool. I'm looking forward to playing more, but I'm going to get Resident Evil out of the way first because Yakuza's going to be a long one.
Yeah.
So I'll get Resident Evil out of the way first and play through that. But it's fantastic and I'm so happy that it's finally here. And yes. Rarity for me, I bought it on disc.
Oh, nice.
So you can borrow it when I've done.
Sweet. Thank you.
There you go.
Like 4 and 5. Just want to get on that. I've still got
that's
them on.
Before them. That's before anything.
Oh yeah, it's just prequel. So yeah,
it's like setting the, and I love the 80s setting as well. By the way, it's
really cool.
Tokyo in the 80s or wherever it is. Japan in the 80s. Just looks great. Just looks awesome. Like it's a barrel of laughs.
Yeah.
And a lot of fighting. Police don't give a shit. Like they're having a massive straightener in the street. It's like 12 Yakuza blokes and you, and
yeah,
and you're just wiping them all out and. There's no police to be found.
Yeah.
It's free for all in 1980s Japan. Good times. But yeah, great game. Delighted it's finally out over here.
Yes, good. We're going to Yakuza 6. 6? 6, yes.
6, it's supposed to be coming this year. I don't think it will.
Yeah, probably not. But then we are getting remakes of the first two, apparently. So.
Yeah, but that's so much Yakuza in 1 year.
That's not Yakuza.
It's going to take me all year to finish Yakuza 0.
Yeah, good point.
Keep it for next year.
Yeah.
Just keep it.
Makes sense.
Not much gaming news this week.
No.
The games with gold for Xbox One and Xbox 360 have been announced.
Ooh.
And they are as follows. He says while still looking for it on his phone.
This is
always a really good selection.
Yeah. I think it's good months recently.
This month's no exception.
Cool.
We have my stupid thumb not working. Right, for Xbox One, we have Lovers in a Dangerous Space-Time.
Oh, yeah. Good card game, that.
Superb name.
Yes. Like, good card game. We should stream it. For sure.
That's available from February the 1st till February the 28th.
Cool.
And Project Cars Digital Edition.
Oh, yeah. I know this.
Which is a good game, and it's very difficult. which is available from February the 16th till March the 15th.
Cool.
Worth checking out, that one.
Yeah, yeah.
For the Xbox 360... we have Monkey Island 2 Special Edition.
All good.
I think the first one was last month, or
I think so.
Is on there now.
It's on there recently, yeah.
Yeah, and Star Wars The Force Unleashed, the first one.
Oh, okay.
Good game.
Yeah.
I've got two, so that's good that I didn't buy one.
Oh, yeah.
Good times. They'll put two on there for you next month.
Probably.
So that's pretty good. Tekken 7, which is a game I'm very excited for, has a release date now.
Excellent.
June the 2nd, 2017. So it's a few months away.
Yeah.
But it looks great. The trailer's great. And I'm very excited for that one.
Cool. Me too. I love me some Tekken.
I love Tekken. I've been playing Tekken since the very first one on PlayStation 1 when Heihachi's hair was basically a square with triangles coming out of it.
Yeah, pretty much.
I love those games.
Yeah, me too.
And I love that they've never sort of left what they started as.
Yeah. They're still been the same sort of fighting game, but just improved over year and year.
Yeah. And I'm really looking forward to this one.
Yeah. Fun moments playing Tekken Tag Tournament, not on holiday in Greece.
Right, okay.
Yeah, there's like a few arcade machines there, at Point Blank and Tekken Tag Tournament.
Oh, Point Blank.
Point Blank is excellent.
Oh, man, I had Point Blank on PS1.
Oh, yeah.
I had the G-Con 45.
Ooh, fancy.
I think I got that with Time Crisis.
Oh, yeah.
The first Time Crisis.
Very cool.
And I bought Point Blank like standalone.
Excellent.
Well, my mum bought it me standalone because I was a tiny person then.
But, yeah.
Point Blank was so cool.
It's so, so cool. I used to have like a high score on it. I think every day that we set it, so every day I'll go back there and get the high score.
Right.
My name, my initials on there.
Man, I love those types of games. I think there's a Point Blank 2 as well, but I never played it.
There was, yeah.
There's about 8 Time Crisis games.
Yeah, there are. It's on PS3, I think.
Reload!
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 Shoot off screen, dude. Reload.
Yep. But yeah, Tekken Tag, I love that. My sister, actually, who's not a gamer at all.
Oh, yeah.
I remember I had Tekken Tag Tournament on PS2, and I went out one day, and I came home, and like she was just sat in my room playing Tekken Tag Tournament,
nice.
And she'd unlocked every character that was missing.
Oh, wow.
Like, have you just been playing this all day? She's like, yeah, I love it. It's amazing. I was like,
what?
The power of Tekken.
But girls don't play games.
Yeah. They only want them for followers and stuff.
Yeah.
Is what the internet would have you believe.
But yes,
of course, that's
yes.
not true. Anyone can play games and it's good.
Of course.
I've got Tekken Tag Tournament 2 on Xbox One because it was free recently.
Nice.
And you missed out.
I did. We just play it.
Yeah, it's awesome.
Excellent.
Okay. Yeah, that's pretty... Oh, one more bit of gaming news, which is pretty cool.
Oh, yeah?
EA Access is giving us a 10-hour trial of Mass Effect Andromeda.
Ooh.
5 days before release, so on March the 16th, we get a 10-hour trial of Mass Effect Andromeda. And of
Excellent.
Course, if you buy it on Xbox One, not only will you get it cheaper through EA Access, you will be able to continue your save, and all your achievements and all that sort of stuff will carry forward when the main game comes out.
Awesome.
Very exciting.
Yeah, very good.
So I'm going to buy it on Xbox One. That means you won't have to buy it.
You're right.
Ah, the magic of sharing your profiles.
Yeah.
Good times.
Good times.
Finn.
Hello.
There's a fuck ton of graps this weekend.
So much graps.
So much graps. All the graps.
Some might say too much.
Maybe, I'll forgive the Royal Rumble.
Yeah,
and I always love NXT.
Yeah, that's true.
But when we record the podcast next week,
we'll be like, oh,
we'll be like,
graps.
God. There's been so much graps. I mean, God, we watched NXT and then we watched 8 hours of Raw Rumble and
oh God.
Then we watched Raw and SmackDown and now it's just like, we just fucking hate wrestling. Oh my God.
Pretty much.
Which is how it is after every pay-per-view, especially when there's an NXT before it as well.
Oh God, yeah.
So we'll get to that in a minute and of course we'll do our predictions, the first predictions of the year.
Yay.
Which is very exciting.
Very.
But let's talk about Raw and SmackDown, the go-home shows leading up to this Sunday's Royal Rumble.
Yes, let's. So I haven't seen SmackDown yet, so I have to leave that to you, unfortunately.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, I have actually watched the wrestling this week, unlike last week where I was just like nodding along, just like, yes.
Yeah, that sounds accurate.
And then basically throwing in my opinion for whatever it's worth.
Yeah. Yeah, we normally watch SmackDown today and Raw on the Tuesday, but didn't get time to watch Raw yesterday, had to watch Raw today, haven't had time to watch SmackDown yet, so sadness. So yeah, Raw was bent last week.
It was.
Which wouldn't be hard to be
fair. It had one very good standout match.
Yes. First match of the night was Luke Gallows versus Cesaro. And he announced a rematch at the Royal Rumble for the titles on the pre-show. Championship matches should not be on the pre-show.
Nope, it cheapens the titles.
It absolutely does.
It's so stupid.
Nobody wants to watch a two-hour pre-show.
No, they don't. I mean, I probably will. I mean, I'm going to a friend's to watch it, and I'm looking forward to that. So we will watch the pre-show. But I just don't think this sort of match should be on the pre-show, which says to me also, and I'll talk about it again in a bit, but excuse me, because it's on the pre-show, I don't see the club winning the titles.
Yeah, me too. It's a shame, because they really should.
Yeah, they absolutely should.
Yeah, so what, ages ago.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was a decent match. Gallows won after distraction from Carl Anderson, and it was fine.
It was just fine.
Yeah.
How many times do you think we use that phrase to describe Rob? Just fine.
All the time, yeah.
This match was just fine.
It was a match.
Yeah, I mean, to be honest, I like that. Now, when New Day sort of lost the titles, they took them completely out of the picture. It's a shame they haven't really done anything good with them, but
yeah.
I'm happy now that they're sort of doing what they used to do. It's like, right, that feud's over, now this feud begins, and the other people can go do something else.
Yeah.
And then focus on that. So it's like Pumpkins said it, didn't he? He was like, used to be like one or two pay-per-views this rivalry had run for.
Oh, yeah.
Then everyone would move on to something else. Like, it was all forgotten, everyone would move on to something else.
Yeah.
It gave some sort of order to wrestling.
It did.
Especially, and it's much needed right now as well.
Yes, it
is. In a very convoluted Raw landscape.
Yes, very convoluted. Then we had the match of the night. Probably the match of the week.
Probably match of the year as far as Raw goes this year so far.
Yeah. Seth Rollins versus Sami Zayn. The winner will be in the Royal Rumble. Or rather, Sami Zayn wanted to be in the Rumble and had to take Seth's spot if he won. something like that.
Yeah, so basically what it was is, so Sammy, if Sammy beat Seth, Sammy would take Seth's spot, and then Seth would not be in the Royal Rumble.
Yeah, that was it.
Okay.
Cool. And yeah, it was excellent. Amazing what you can do when you put two insanely talented wrestlers in the ring.
Yeah, it's funny. It's funny that. I mean, it's amazing they haven't thought of it before.
I know, seriously.
Well, I wonder what these guys could do together if given a good chunk of time. We're not going to find out this week, but here's Titus O'Neil in the New Day. This is the thing, right? And this is what this is what we need more of.
Yep.
Less garbage, less backstage nonsense that we don't need.
Yep.
More, I mean, we're watching it for wrestling. Yep, the storyline's fine. If they needed to enhance things and move things along, fine, but they don't need to be drawn out, you know, all the time.
Yeah, exactly.
These two told a great story off a very simple thing.
Yeah.
Sammy wanted what Seth has.
Yes.
Seth wanted to defend what he already had. Story created.
Exactly.
Tell a story. Go and tell that story, guys.
Exactly.
And they did.
They're both very, very good guys. Very good wrestlers or sports entertainers.
Yeah. It's not wrestling anymore. It's sports entertainment.
Yes, of course.
Vince McMahon listens to this podcast right now and be like, that's right.
Sports entertainers, yes.
Yes.
I like these guys. Yeah. we knew James Ellsworth. James Ellsworth's.
Oh no, please no. I'd rather be the new Charlie, whatever her name is.
Oh yeah.
I think I've mentioned this before, but I think they're tarting her up.
You think so?
Yeah, because like before she was like very conservatively dressed.
Yeah.
She had nice straight hair, was very serious. Hi, I'm on Raw. And all this. That's her voice, but
yeah, so good, yeah.
I thought it was a really good impression, to be
excellent,
honest.
Yeah, great impression.
Yeah.
It's like a Mitchell McMahon impression.
It's so accurate that it should be called the Games, Graps, and Very Accurate Impressions podcast.
Yes, exactly.
Which isn't at all a mouthful.
No, not.
So, but it's like recently there's been a bit of cleavage in there.
Hmm.
And this week she had a bit more skin and her hair was like frizzier and different.
Flippy.
Like, hey, go out there and be trendy. Show some boob. You know, it's
hashtag show some boob.
Yeah, hashtag Charlie show some boob.
That's going to be his episode title this week. Hashtag show some boob.
Yeah. Anyway, that's just a little observation.
Yes, good observation.
Where were we? Cesaro, no, wait, Sammy versus Seth.
Yes, so the match ended when Sammy was going for a haluva kick on the ring apron. Seth counted into a pedigree on the ring apron. Ouch. Hardest part of the ring, did you know?
Yep, they keep mentioning it. They want you to know that that's the hardest spot of the ring.
Yeah.
Probably the ring post is probably the hardest spot of the ring. I just want to say that.
Yeah, probably. It's a good point.
Okay. If you pedigreed him on there, he'd probably die. So.
True. So Seth went to pin him, and then Triple H's music hits. Oh my goodness.
Oh my Lord.
Crowd went nuts. Cut to the crowd shot of some guy jumping around, going nuts.
Just loves Triple H.
Yeah.
So, oh my God, if Triple H was on Raw every week, like, he'd just be like, oh, fucking hell.
Again.
Authority segment for 20 minutes. But because he's going to wrestle, he's been in the gym, pulling them chains and doing things at midnight that when other people are sleeping.
And it's a good music as well. Not his crappy, bow down to it, okay.
I hate that.
Yeah, I like it either. Time to play a game.
Yeah, that's the best music. That's probably why everyone was going nuts.
It was, but yes, finally got his good music back, yeah.
If they wanted to play his good music, they'd have his... The awesome one from
his original one.
not the Hemsley one. The other one.
Yeah,
that one. Yeah.
Yeah,
that wasn't a very good impression.
It was crap,
but
yeah.
It was something like that.
Yeah,
that is that
yeah,
one.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Also, not a good impression of it, but still better than Finn's.
Yeah, right.
We've really like
we've
not, it's not like we're trying to drag the podcast out or anything. We're just sort of
we're tired from repeated efforts to try and record this dumb thing.
Yeah, we're just sort of spitballing.
We've lost the plot a little bit.
Yeah, our heads are gone.
Yep. So Triple H didn't come out.
What?
I know. Seth was waiting for him. Didn't happen. So went to pin Sammy. Sammy rolled him up and won. Got the three count. Sammy Zayn's going to be in the Rumble, and Seth
is not
out.
Okay, so where does this leave Seth now? So Seth's not going to be in the Royal Rumble at all.
Good question. I wonder who's going to come down. Maybe Triple H is going to be in the Rumble, and Seth's going to come down and cost Triple H the match?
Maybe. Or Seth comes down for a promo during the Royal Rumble.
Maybe.
Not the match itself.
Yeah.
Sorry, we've been drinking fizzy pop. Yes. Usually we've... so if you're hearing breaks, it's because we're like... We're trying, we're like burping, but we're trying not to burp on the mic because that's completely disgusting.
Yeah.
We usually have a very English thing to say. Cordial. They don't have that anywhere else in the world. That word.
Yeah. Yeah,
that word is exclusive to this country.
It's true.
Cordial.
Cordial. Cordial. That's more meaning.
It's a weird word.
It is.
Yeah. I remember a family member from America was over. And the idea of cordial was just so alien.
Really?
Yeah. Like, wait, so you, this is going to be an American accent. So I apologize if there's people in America that listen to this. Griff, I'm so sorry.
Sorry, Griff.
wait.
Nailed it.
Yeah, I nailed it. That's it. So you guys put juice and then you add water to it. That was it. That was literally the conversation. It was like, great. Yeah, that's exactly what we do.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Oh, okay.
Oh, right, cool. Totally. Awesome.
God, what is...
Boy, howdy.
This, what?
Boy, howdy.
Boy, howdy?
Yeah.
Like, everybody from America in Texas?
Yeah.
Ah,
okay. Everyone in America is from the country, right?
Sorry?
Everyone,
yeah, they all wear cowboy hats.
Exactly, yeah. That's how I imagine it. Everyone's JBL, basically.
Oh, yeah, that's it. Yeah. That's exactly how I think America is as well.
Yeah.
I've actually been there, and I can confirm that's exactly how it is.
Oh, good, okay. Everyone's in cowboy hats and...
Yep, cowboy hats. everyone, yeah, basically, yeah.
Cool.
Everything's bigger in America.
Good to know.
Yeah. Sorry, Griff.
Yeah, sorry, Griff. right, well, where were we? What were we talking about? Seth Rollins, what's he doing?
Yeah, well, I mean, this is... Where does this leave Seth now?
Yeah, so good question.
He could come down in sort of the middle of the pay-per-view, be like, ah, should be in the Royal Rumble. Ah.
Seth Rollins.
Good combined Seth Rollins impression.
Yeah, very good.
What a week for impressions this has been.
This has been great.
And then you'll get Stephanie's garbage music.
A crane down. Bada-bing, bada-bing. We're losing it. We've lost it.
Losing it? It's gone.
Oh, God.
And then she'll obviously say that Triple H isn't there and he's not going to be in the Raw Rumble. There'll be some back and forth and maybe Triple H will come out of the crowd or maybe they'll save it for Raw and we don't know what's going to happen with Seth Rollins.
Yeah, who knows?
Or, what you said could happen, Triple H could be in the Royal Rumble for... I don't know why Triple H would be in the Royal Rumble.
Yeah, shitting girls.
Yeah. Sure. But it was the long and short of it is, I know we've gone the long way around, but Sammy versus Seth was superb.
Very good. More of that. Yes. So the next match we had was it's a fun little six-man cruiserweight match. Excuse me. Mustafa Ali and others.
Who was it? Mustafa Ali...
Jack Gallagher.
TJ Perkins.
Yep.
And Jack Gallagher.
Versus...
Jack Gallagher.
Gallagher, yes.
Against Drew Gulak, Tony Nese, and Aria Davari.
That's the ones. And yeah, it was good. Very short. Should have been longer, but cool.
It was
match.
Very flippy floppy. I liked it.
Flippy floppy. Obviously, there to put Mustafa Ali over.
100% the reason that match was even there.
Yeah.
To get that inverted 450 splash over, which, by the way, is awesome.
It's so good. Yeah. Good stuff.
Good stuff. To be honest, that's good. They're introducing a new face into the cruiserweight division who maybe people... All they need is one big move.
Yeah.
Like Neville, probably no one really cared until he started doing until he did the red arrow. Everyone's like, woohoo! Yeah. Neville, flippy floppy!
Flippy shit, yay!
Yeah! Yeah! And he does an inverted 450. The crowd are like,
whoa!
Wait! Who is this?
Who is this mysterious man we've never seen before?
Yeah.
Oh, except we have.
Yeah. Oh, but he was on 205 Live. We don't watch that. We only watch
Yeah,
one.
Yeah. 205 Live, not doing
Hashtag
that
205 Live.
Yeah. 205 Live, not doing that well, apparently. One of the lowest rated things on the network at the minute.
Are you surprised with how poorly represented the Cruiserweight division is on Raw?
Not at all. But it's a shame.
It's a big shame, yeah.
Yeah.
And it's a shame that it's not doing very well. It's, I mean, I like it.
Me too. I watch it.
But still needs to be in a smaller setting.
Yeah,
but I also think that the NXT, it should be on NXT.
Yeah, agreed. Anyway, so we had yet another New Day segment. went on forever.
I fast forwarded it. I saw them coming down, and I was like, I'm not watching this because I know what's going to happen.
Yeah. So basically ended up in a big match. New Day versus Enzo and Cass versus Titus. New Day and Enzo and Cass versus Titus O'Neil, Rusev, and Jinder Mahal.
Handsome Rusev,
and Braun Strowman as well.
Sure. This is the thing. Like, why is that match happening?
I don't know.
What the hell has Braun Strowman got to do with this?
Yeah, well, they've got to make it look strong, I guess. Yeah, it was a dark match. Braun Strowman ate Enzo Amore. And then as Braun was celebrating in the ring, well, it's the Big Show. And the Big Show's back.
Pockins predicted this ages ago that it was going to be Big Show that confronted Braun.
Yeah.
So kudos to you, Pockins, for that.
Yeah.
Well done, Steve.
To be fair, Big Show's looking good. He's been in the gym, obviously. Best shape of his career. As they always say, every time he comes back.
They do, don't they? Yeah.
Yeah.
Hashtag best shape of his career.
Yeah. So that's fine. That's going to be a thing that happens probably at...
In the Royal Rumble match.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
Oh, God!
Who can possibly eliminate Braun Strowman and or the Big Show?
Ten men.
Far too huge. Yeah,
they'll get like 10 men together and they'll just all tip him over.
Same thing every year, yeah.
Yeah. Like back in the 90s, Repo Man will come down and he'll be part of this elimination of the big guy. And yeah, that's how it always works, basically.
Pretty much. Then we had Jericho versus Roman Reigns again.
What? Wait, what do you mean again? They've never fought.
Oh, yeah, of course, yeah. They've never fought in the last 17 weeks.
They've not been on Raw for a long time, so no, you're right, maybe you should cool off on on that hate.
Yeah, I'm not hating.
I don't know what you're talking about. Get your facts straight, Finn.
So, yeah, it was a match. It was fine. We've seen it before. Roman won via DQ when Kevin Owens came down and attacked.
Well, that never happens.
Yeah. Big surprise. Kevin Owens ended up getting locked in a cage by our toys.
Yeah, basically, if you didn't know, WWE have a shark cage toy. I don't know why.
Yeah,
I guess if you want to relive classic WWE matches, such as Triple H versus Owen Hart from Unforgiven 99, you can do that.
Knowledge.
But, yeah, buy our toys.
Yeah. So we had Nia Jax versus some lady. Nia Jax won. And then Sasha Banks came down and beat it to death with a... what do they call them? A crutch.
A crutch, yeah.
Yeah. And that was the
beat her to death.
Yeah.
Jesus, that's brutal.
No, just hit her a bunch and then she did like a tope suicida to the outside.
Yeah, she beat her to death, but her resurrection will be Sunday on the pre-show.
Yes.
That's another match on the pre-show, isn't it?
Yes, another pre-show match. Which
remember when Sasha Banks was fighting like in the main event?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sorry. Mm-hmm. Then we had yet another short cruiserweight match. Rich Swann versus Noam Dar. Good match, but give them more time. You have three hours to fill what you're doing.
I honestly think that Alicia Fox screeching was given more time than the match.
Probably. Weird storyline. But
I just don't understand how it's gotten to that. I don't know if I've missed something or what, but all of a sudden she's in love with Noam Dar and she's screeching and protecting him and Cedric Alexander's a bad man and what the fuck is going on? What is this?
Yeah, so... Apparently, the rumor is Vince McMahon likes the way Noam Dar says Alyssa Fox.
Yeah, I've heard
because
that.
Because it sounds like Alyssa something else. Yeah,
Fox. Exactly. I'll just say it.
Yeah, yeah, you can say it.
Alyssa Fox.
Alyssa Fox. Yeah.
I'm not sure it does sound like.
It doesn't at all.
Fox.
No.
But if Vince McMahon thinks it's funny, then
whatever.
Of course, it's hilarious.
Yeah, I mean, I like Noam Dar. He's a great wrestler. I like Rich Swann. He's a great wrestler. I like Cedric Alexander. He's a great wrestler. But just give them more time, please.
I don't like. I like Alyssa Fox when. Like she, I like the crazy stuff.
Fine. Yeah,
but it was too much this week. I was like, God, I can't believe this. Like, the screeching was unbearable.
Yeah, it was too much. I agree. Should be better. And then the ending was I skipped the ending. To be honest, it was more Goldberg, more in the second, more Brock Lesnar staring off.
Well, I did watch it, and I mean Goldberg needs to
chill out. Yeah, I did see that. Actually.
Calm down. I mean, he was bleeding and sweating, and he looked ridiculous. Then the fans chanted Goldberg, and Goldberg forgot his lines.
Oh God!
So flubbed his promo, and then Paul Heyman thankfully came out and saved the day.
Thank goodness.
Brock Lesnar turned up for one of his scheduled appearances.
Yeah, said nothing.
They literally said nothing, like he always does. To be fair, when he does say stuff, it's like, hey, Grandpa. I saw a funny video of when Brock was WWE champion, SmackDown champion back in the day.
Hmm.
And there was like a mariachi band in the ring.
Oh, yeah.
And Brock came down in a Mexican Like in a what are them hats called?
I don't know. Like a Mexican hat.
Yeah, okay, we'll just call it that. Mexican hat.
I know what you mean. What are they called?
Sombrero.
That's it, sombrero. Okay. Well done.
He came down with sombrero, and I think he may have had maracas, and he was dancing. I'll show when we've done. I'll show you the video.
Yeah.
I prefer Brock then. That was way better.
Yeah, agreed. Oh dear.
And I think he beat the crap out of the mariachi band, but like I didn't. To be honest, I just watched him dancing. It was funny.
Yeah, I think I vaguely remember that actually.
Brock came down. They stared. Undertaker came down.
Yeah.
But he appeared.
Oh yeah, it's a bit out
of
nowhere.
And it was the weirdest ending to Raw. Ever, they were all just looking at each other. Goldberg's bleeding and sweating. Brock's backing away from Undertaker. Undertaker looks like your granddad who's drunk at a wedding. And it was just weird. And then the purple lights came on. The bongs were still going. And
yeah, music playing.
Gongs, not weird. Bongs. Bongataker. Yeah, and then Raw finished. It was like, okay.
Yeah, weird one.
I saw what happened after Raw. And they literally all just got out of the ring.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I saw it on Twitter, actually.
I don't know. I mean, are they trying to hint that they could have a triple threat match at WrestleMania?
Yeah. I'm struggling to care about them, to be honest.
Well, I am a little bit. I mean, I like Goldberg, and I always have.
Yeah.
I've gone off Brock over the last sort of stretch of time. This run has not done anything for me. I like Undertaker, but I wish they'd have carried on with the storyline when he turned up on SmackDown that day and threatened the whole team. And
yeah, that was way cooler than what's going on now.
So I just don't understand where they're at. I mean, hopefully we'll find out more after the Royal Rumble, but very strange. And I mean, I don't know. I think things will start to take shape after the Royal Rumble.
I hope so.
So let's talk about SmackDown. Okay. There wasn't a lot to report, to be honest. It wasn't a great show. I have watched most of it.
Yeah. It was the first match with Randy Orton versus Luke Harper, which was pretty good, actually.
Which was to relieve tension in the Wyatt family.
Yes.
Still firmly believe that we're headed for Randy Orton versus Bray Wyatt at WrestleMania.
It's going to be, my plan all along was to break up the Wyatts on the inside, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
That's going to be it.
That is going to be it, yeah.
Yeah, it's so obvious.
And you can listen to these podcasts going back. And since this started, and when it first started, we were like, I don't see the point in this. We know what's going to happen.
Yeah.
And we'll say we told you so when it does happen.
Yep.
If of course, it doesn't happen, we're just going to delete the podcast off the RSC, to be honest. So,
yes.
Including this one. Yep, no. That was fine. Randy Orton won.
Yep. RKO out of nowhere.
Sure.
Yep.
But, I mean, there was a segment with Mickie James. Yep. Where she basically addressed why she turned up. Do we think it was actually her as La Luchadora? Because, I mean, it obviously was last week, but before that, because when they showed the footage, and I don't mean to sound crass, but Mickie James has got considerably bigger breasts than the other, or at least what seemed to be the other La Luchadoras.
I hadn't noticed.
I mean, La Luchadora turned up with cannons last week on SmackDown.
It's true.
I don't know, maybe it wasn't, they just, I don't know.
Yeah,
either way, point. Doesn't really matter. Yeah. But
need to do side by side.
Yeah.
Some in-depth comparisons.
Yes, sure. Side on comparisons.
Yeah.
Yeah. and Mickey is an interesting one. Her promo was,
I like the story.
Strange.
Yeah, I like the story they've brought in, saying that, like, oh, they're talking like this is the Women's Revolution, but they talking like what we did wasn't an accomplishment and back in the day with Trish Stratus.
Yeah. And I liked when she started shouting. I thought, well, this is good, a bit of aggression, but she was talking like this and like dragging things out. And I was like, well, why are you doing that?
Are you talking in slow motion?
I don't understand why you're talking like this. It just doesn't make any sense. And so that was weird.
Yeah.
But I like it. I like that she's there.
Thought maybe she forgot her lines halfway through. She was like stalling for time. He's like, Women Revolution, Trish Stratus.
I mean, overall, I think she did a good job.
Yeah, she was. It was a good storyline. It's good for him, I thought. Yeah.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah,
that's what I thought.
Becky came out, so it looks like we're going to have Mickey versus Becky.
Yeah.
And it looks like Alexa's going to move on to different. Well, that's it, actually. Alexa came out and helped Mickey, but I think that's going to be. I do think the overall thing of this is to have Mickey versus Becky and then to push Alexa to defend against someone else.
Yeah, I think so. That'd be good.
Coincidentally, later on in the show, Naomi opened an open challenge to somebody.
Oh, yeah.
Alexa did come down and said, basically, you're not in my league.
Ah, that's going to be the thing then. Okay.
And she said, say hello to Obscurity.
Ooh.
Which I enjoyed.
Yeah.
So that's fine. I mean, Naomi's good, I guess.
Yeah, Naomi's good.
So that'll be a program. Yeah. So Mickey versus Becky, Alexa versus
Naomi.
I'm fine with it.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
The SmackDown Women's Division is strong.
Yeah, I think so.
Where it didn't look it at the start.
No, it's improved.
No, it's looking great.
Yeah, good stuff.
We had an AJ Styles and John Cena segment.
Which was good.
John Cena is portraying a very interesting character to me at the minute. He's gone. I don't know if you've seen the segment from this week or not.
I haven't yet.
But basically, he was talking like he was when he was doing the whole rap gimmick.
Oh, yeah.
So he was talking like that, and it was coming across as very heelish and very sort of the arrogant, he's basically sort of like, oh, I haven't got respect because I didn't come up through the indies. It's like, I wasn't built for the indies. I was built for the WWE.
Ooh.
And of course, he went on to, I'm John Cena, recognize.
Recognize.
Then he left, and it's like, I don't understand what this character is. Are they trying to turn him heel?
I feel like he's trying to play both sides. There's two different fans in your attendance. Like, John Cena fans, like little kids and mums.
He came out with new merch as well.
Oh, yeah.
It was terrible as well, by the way.
Was it? Oh.
Awful.
And then you got fans like us who like AJ Styles and Kevin Owens and the indie guys. So I think it's trying to be a heel to the guys like the indie guys like us, while still being a face to the mums and the kids.
There's only so long that's going to fly.
Yeah, probably.
But I did enjoy... I'm enjoying his work at the minute. I'm a Cena fan anyway.
Yeah,
And I really do like the promos that he's sort of giving us at the minute with this persona that he's giving off. I do see a heel turn in the future.
Good.
Still.
Yeah.
But I think it's closer now more than it ever has been.
Yeah.
Because I think they're testing the waters with it.
Yeah, I think you're right. It's an experiment. See how it goes.
Yeah.
I
see it and I hear the arrogant stuff and I'm like, okay, I'm fine with it.
Yeah.
And I think it's great. And eventually I think, it'll get to a point where it will turn on it will turn the kids off and they'll start rooting for someone else against Cena and that sort of thing. They could absolutely play it that way and it would work.
Yeah, look great.
But it's a bedding in process with it.
Yeah, I think so.
Much like before when he came in and he was clean cut and then all of a sudden he comes back and he's a rapper and it was great.
Yeah.
He even sort of mentioned one of his songs he was like, I'm still a bad, bad man and all this sort of stuff. And that's when he said, I'm John Cena, recognized. And then he literally just dropped the mic and left and like his music played. And
nice. I like it.
Yeah, I like it too. I could do without the colourful t-shirts. but I think if he does turn heel or at least go more towards that side of things, because the line between heel and face now is very thin.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, seriously.
Blurred for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of Cena.
Yeah,
good. Especially the way he's going at the minute.
Good stuff.
So that was that. Which there was a number one. There was a battle royal to determine who was going in the Royal Rumble.
Yeah.
Baron Corbin was on commentary. He's already in the Royal Rumble, of course.
Cool.
Mojo Rawley won it. It was basically full of tag teams. So you had Heath and Rhino, The Ascension, Breezango. Who else was in there? Mojo was on his own.
Oh yeah.
And Kurt Hawkins was there, so that would have been Zack Ryder.
I see. Okay.
Mojo won it, so he's in the Royal Rumble. Ugh, some Mojo wasted slot. That's what that is.
That's a wasted slot. Well done.
Yeah. So that's the thing. I think while Zack Ryder's out, we might actually see a bit of a push for Mojo here.
Yay.
No.
Ray for Mojo.
So that sucks. We had Dolph Ziggler versus Kalisto, and that's sort of tied in with the Dolph Ziggler versus Apollo Crews feud that they're obviously wanting on a pre-show in the near future.
Yeah. Poor Bolly.
Yeah, they showed the footage again of Ziggler super kicking Jerry Lawler in the chest.
Yeah.
I caused your heart attack, old man. Fucking die.
Jesus
basically.
Calm down, Dolph. Jeez.
And, come on now.
Have a Snickers.
Yeah. You're a little cranky when you're hungry.
Yeah.
You want to give old men heart attacks and things. So that's the thing. And then we had the main event, which was a lumberjack match between The Miz and Dean Ambrose. The Miz and Dean Ambrose for the IC title.
No, wacky Dean Ambrose.
Yeah. I was talking about this with my friend, actually. We were talking about... this is going to... Oh, okay. Let me finish talking about... Dean Ambrose won. They're having a rematch at the Royal Rumble. Fine.
Cool.
That was SmackDown.
Okay, cool.
We were having a conversation about Roman Reigns and how, like, his in-ring stuff hasn't changed since they were in the Shield.
Pretty much.
And but the fans have really turned on him.
Yeah.
Rollins, he was obviously the champion, and we sort of under the impression that Dean is like the not progressed the best, because obviously this lunatic fringe gimmick is incredibly forced. Where you didn't need to mention it in the Shield, and you knew he was sort of crazy and different.
He was kind of a badass in the Shield.
Yeah, but he was still sort of a loose cannon, and that's what was good about him. But now, of course, he's on his own, and they allude to it. I mean, I don't like it.
Yeah, it's like JBL goes nuts on it. Oh, he's a lunatic. We don't want lunatics on a WWE champion, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
It's like, you're making it worse. You're not helping.
It's like, JBL, you know we're not buying this crap, right? Because Renee Young goes out with him. Do you think he would go out with a psychopath?
He's on total leave it every week.
He's on total, he's on holiday with Daniel Bryan.
I feel like he'd work better as a heel, maybe.
I think so. I mean, I always thought that anyway. When the Shield were heels before they suddenly, crossed that very thin line between heels and faces.
Yeah.
I like Dean Ambrose then. He was very, very cool.
Yeah, me too.
I still have hope for Ambrose.
Yeah, yeah. He's a good wrestler.
We need to have that gimmick forced down us.
I agree.
But basically, the long and short of it is we feel fairly sorry for Roman and the shit that he gets. When in the Shield, like, people were so into him.
Yeah,
like,
people loved him.
Oh, the drive-by, everyone's going absolutely ballistic for it. The spear, everyone's doing the ooh-ah thing before it.
The
power bombing through the table, and everyone's going ballistic for Reigns.
Yeah.
Breaks off from the Shield. Boom. Fuck Reigns! What is this crap every week? What are you doing?
Wrestling fans are fickle.
I mean, yes, we've given Roman Reigns some crap, but when you sit back and put it into perspective, Roman's had a really rough deal.
Yes, poor Roman.
Yeah, bad times. Okay, so let's move on to the Royal Rumble.
Okay.
Royal
Rumble.
I'm looking forward to it.
Me too.
Now, let me ask you a question.
Okay.
Has anything on SmackDown over the last few weeks given you any indication that a SmackDown guy could actually win this thing?
No, not so much.
No.
I'm trying to think of any promo or anything. Did you mention the Royal Rumble?
Exactly. See, the only mention that I can really think of is Baron Corbin on commentary watching the Royal Rumble, I keep saying number one contender, the Royal Rumble placement match, which Mojo Rawley won. And he's not going to win it.
No.
I mean, Baron Corbin could win it, but I think it's too early for him to main event WrestleMania.
Yeah.
Which is the same reason that Braun Strowman won't win it, because it's way too early for him.
Maybe next year.
Maybe. So it's weird because I still think the person who wins the Royal Rumble is going to go for the SmackDown title, not the Raw title, based on my previous theory.
Yeah.
So let's talk about the Royal Rumble. Let's run down the matches and we'll sort of talk about what we think to the build-up and how we see things panning out.
Yes, we'll go through our predictions. Right. So, starting on the pre-show, we have Sasha Banks versus Nia Jax. Probably shouldn't have been the pre-show, but what do we know?
Sure.
Yeah. So
is it a 4-hour show, the Royal Rumble, this year?
I think so. I know that they said the pre-show was 2 hours long. That's a good 6 hours of wrestling there for you.
You have to know WWE. We don't need to see backstage interviews.
Yeah.
We don't care who's in the social media lounge. We just don't care. We like, just give us the extra matches on the pay-per-view and we'll tolerate it.
Yeah. I don't know. Damn.
I don't care about Shawn Michaels being on the guest panel.
Yeah.
Guys. It's not like actual sports where you debate real stats and stuff like this.
Yeah.
Like, you're not proving us anything. Like, you're trying to predict an already scripted show.
Yeah.
It just, like, the kickoff panel just doesn't make any sense to me.
Yeah.
I understand that they want to present it like actual sports, but the matter of the fact is, it isn't actual sports. It's still professional wrestling.
Yep.
Sorry to shit on it, but.
We know what you mean. Yeah, it's fine.
It's the truth.
It is.
The truth shall set you free.
Yes.
Remember when he walked out to no music and that just played?
Oh, God, yeah. Garbage. Yeah, now R-Truth did have like a title shot against John Cena at some point, didn't he?
R-Truth had so much potential.
Did he?
In TNA,
is a bit of a...
he was the world champion.
Was he? Jesus.
Ron the Truth Killings was the world champion.
Yeah, that's why.
Turns upon SmackDown. I think he had like street vignettes as well. Like,
oh, yeah.
He was hanging out and he was like rapping in the streets and stuff. I think I'm right. Yeah. I think he had like that type of build up. Then he turned up and he was rapping. And he was like, just fuck off, K-Corp.
Yeah. Oh dear. So, Sasha versus Nia. Who's going to win?
Nia.
Okay.
They're going to play on this Sasha Banks being injured and not at full capability.
Interesting.
And my prediction is this will carry forth to WrestleMania and it'll be a four-way for the women's title.
Hmm.
But for now, Nia wins.
Okay. I'm going to say Sasha wins. She overcomes the odds and wins because she's Sasha Banks and she's really good, apparently.
Sure.
Yeah. So I'll say that. Just be different.
Okay.
Then we have Cesaro and Sheamus versus Gallows and Anderson for the tag team championships.
Heart says the club. Mm-hmm. Head says Cesaro and Sheamus.
Yeah.
It just... You can't change the tag team titles on the pre-show. You just can't.
Yeah, I agree. Makes no sense. I'm going to say Cesaro and Sheamus as well.
I think the last time I remember a title changing, and correct me if I'm wrong, on a kickoff show or Sunday Night Heat...
Okay.
Was when Jerry Lynn won the light heavyweight title before Backlash 2001.
Wow, good memory.
Thank you. Because Paul Heyman was on commentary and they alluded to it sort of on the show. They were like, Jerry Lynn has made his debut on Heat and won the light heavyweight championship. Sorry, not the cruiserweight title. Ooh,
so many championships back in the day.
Who did he beat? I can't remember who he beat. But either way, he won the light heavyweight title on the Heat before Backlash.
Nice.
There you go.
Memory.
I don't know if any other titles have changed hands on pre-shows since?
I have no idea. I can barely remember. What was the last pay-per-view? Exactly. Right. What was
the last pay-per-view?
Back, I don't know. No.
TLC?
TLC, that was it.
Okay.
Well done. So we have the first match of the night, I think, according to WWE.com. We have Becky Lynch, Nikki Bella, and Naomi versus Alexa Bliss, Mickie James, and Natalya. Why isn't this on the pre-show?
Why is that not on the pre-show?
That's my
and why is the tag team title match on the pre-show? Surely just swap them. Is it a thing of you can't have two women's matches on the pre-show? They'll think we're being sexist.
That's what I thought as well. So, they can't have two women. Yeah, it's dumb.
That's so stupid. That is very poor.
Agreed.
I don't care who wins, but I think the heel team will win.
Me too. Simply because Mickie James there. You don't want Mickie James to lose her first.
She'll score the pinfall. Exactly, get over Becky, or maybe even Nikki if they want to be funny about it.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I'll say
because Mickie James used to go out with John Cena, that's why.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yes, that was the whole thing. The whole backstage drama that happened. With Kenny Dykstra involved as well. That was weird.
Sure.
so then we have the Cruiserweight Championship match, Rich Swann versus Neville.
I'm surprised this isn't on the pre-show.
Yeah, that's not.
Yeah, me too. Is it Neville's time?
I think so. I think Neville has helped the Cruiserweight division somewhat. He's given it an injection, a dose of excitement, just because of just from the heel turn and his new character development, I guess.
I guess you can't be the king of the Cruiserweights if you aren't the Cruiserweight champion.
Yeah.
Now, I would rather Rich Swann carry on being the champion for a bit longer. Because we haven't really had a defending champion properly, because obviously TJ Perkins lost it, then Brian Kendrick lost it, and has seemingly disappeared off the face of the earth.
Oh yeah, it wasn't last week, was he? We went to your wife live this week, probably.
Sure. And now Rich Swann has it, and I don't get me wrong, I do think Neville's going to win.
Okay.
But I don't think he should. Not yet.
Yeah.
But if you're going to forward this character of the King of the Cruiserweights, then he has to win it.
Yeah, agreed. And who beats him, do you think? Austin Neville wins, inevitably.
Austin Aries.
Ooh, good one. Good prediction.
I don't know how far away Aries is from coming back, but he is a cert. I mean, he's going to be in the division. They keep talking about it.
Keep alluding to it, yeah.
What's going to happen is Austin Aries, I think it'll be sort of Neville calls out Austin Aries. Or Neville's like, oh, who is there anyone even worthy of fighting me for the title or all this sort of stuff?
Yeah, it's not great enough. Hint to beat me, Neville.
Yeah, exactly. And then Austin Aries, he rises from the announce table and he announces himself not only going to be on Raw, but but he'll be on 205 Live as well. And I think it'll probably be Austin Aries who takes it from him. That is the only, and I don't want to sort of say realistic, but realistic person who could beat him, because Austin Aries, and that'd be a fucking awesome match as well.
Yeah, would, yeah, be so good. Yeah, good prediction. I like it.
Don't get me wrong, I'm not against Mustafa Ali taking it from him.
No, no.
But because you can build any feud, it's wrestling. I mean, Jesus.
Exactly, yeah.
But from how I see it, just from looking at it in the future, I mean, I just can't look past Austin Aries versus Neville.
Yeah, that'd be a good match for sure. So then we have Charlotte Flair versus Bayley for the women's title.
Charlotte wins. No, it's not even a thing. Charlotte wins.
Really? Not even an inkling of,
nope,
maybe?
Not yet. She'll lose it at WrestleMania. I'm so confident of it as well.
Yeah.
You can have it. I'll put it on the bets.
You think so?
I'll put it on the bets. Charlotte is going to lose that title at WrestleMania. That impeccable winning pay-per-view winning streak won't end until Mania.
Okay. I'm going to take the bet. I'll take the bet. Add it to our total. So let me tell you. Charlotte loses title at WrestleMania.
Great story for Bayley as well, because I think she'll be the one who wins it. I'm not gonna put that in my bets, but I just think from WWE fan growing up and all this sort of, they'll have this sort of big dramatic thing where, like, they show all the, I mean, like they did on Raw this week, they show with all the wrestlers and stuff growing up, and then she's fighting at WrestleMania for the women's title and grandest stage and all this sort of stuff, and she'll win it, I think.
Okay, I want to say Bayley for this one, just to be different again, and I don't know. It's an outside
bet. They're going to yo-yo the women's title even more.
Yes, because that's what they do, apparently.
It's so stupid.
I know, but I don't know. I don't know. Think of the merch they could sell as Bayley, with Bayley as champion. All the little kids with the Bayley merch and the t-shirts and whatnot.
After WrestleMania. Yeah, of course.
Yeah. I don't know. I'm probably wrong on that.
The Bayley merch is already selling.
Yeah, you're right. It's an outside bet. I'm going to take it anyway, just because.
Okay.
Then we have Kevin Owens versus Roman Reigns with Chris Jericho dangling from a cell for some reason.
So the US title is not on the line.
Nope.
At the Royal Rumble.
Yeah, apparently not.
I think Reigns wins. I really do.
But I don't want him. I mean, I like Roman Reigns, don't get me wrong. I know we just said I do like Roman, but
this is the and Reigns winning is the reason the Raw Championship won't be the main event at WrestleMania.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah, you're waiting to be Reigns, isn't it?
I mean, it just seems from a storyline perspective that makes the most sense.
It does. It's just Chris Oak is not there to help, and yeah, now you're right. It's gonna be Reigns. I'm gonna say Reigns as well. Then we have probably one of the less predictable matches of the night. AJ Styles versus John Cena. John Cena.
I know that they've been saying that Taker versus Cena is off the cards for WrestleMania.
Sadly.
I'm not buying it.
No?
No. Just like Kurt Angle saying he's not going to be in the Royal Rumble. I'm not buying that either.
No?
I'm sorry, but he's cancelled his appearance at Five Star Wrestling this weekend.
Oh, is he?
He was due to be on commentary.
Oh, really?
And he's now not on commentary.
That being said, he is going to be wrestling in WCPW on February the 19th.
That's not this Sunday, though, is it?
It's not. It's after the Rumble. So, yeah.
So, I think he might turn up in the Royal Rumble.
Cool. I mean, I'd love to see him in the Rumble.
I mean, so they're saying that Cena versus Taker is off the cards. I'm not buying it. I think that is that Vince McMahon has such a hard-on for that match that it's got to happen. And if it's going to happen, it has to happen this year. It has to. Because Taker's got to have surgery again.
Oh, is he? Jeez.
So, I mean, for me, Undertaker's done after this run.
Probably.
So he either has the match with Cena, wins the title at WrestleMania, and loses it at some point down the line to AJ Styles or whoever, I don't care.
Yeah.
But Cena wins the title, and this means something new for AJ Styles because the Elimination Chamber pay-per-view is SmackDown. So AJ Styles' WrestleMania opponent will sort of be determined maybe around then.
Cool.
I'm sticking with Samoa Joe. I really am sticking with Samoa Joe for AJ Styles.
That'd be awesome.
Yeah, that's what I'm going for. Cool. I'm going for Cena to win the belt. So both titles change hands.
Okay. I'm going to go with AJ Styles.
Okay.
Because, I don't know. Rumors, I don't know. I'm not one to believe random internet rumors. But I don't know.
Can
I
think you see AJ Styles headlining WrestleMania?
I would like it. I'd like to see it for sure. But
can you see AJ Styles headlining WrestleMania? Right, yeah. Now, think about it. Can you see AJ Styles being the main event at WrestleMania?
I guess not. But I want it, but in...
Hey, I want it too.
Because Roman Reigns and bloody WrestleMania. But yeah.
Hey, we've defended Reigns.
I do like Reigns, but...
You can't turn on him so quickly.
Yeah, but AJ Styles, though.
I know.
But he's really, really good, though.
Yeah, but... In fact, on the on SmackDown, going back, like, his head is on the poster.
Oh, really?
Like, but way back. Like, right next to Sasha Banks.
Oh.
On the poster, AJ Styles.
Oh, right.
Like, the front four is Cena, Taker, Goldberg, and Brock on the Royal Rumble poster.
For God's sake.
AJ Styles is right at the back.
That's stupid.
Oh, it's ridiculous.
But, yeah. I don't know. Maybe we'll win it there. Maybe lose it at Elimination Chamber to Cena. I don't know. But I'm going to say AJ for now.
They're hell-bent on having Cena win that title again.
For sure. For sure. So that's that. So for the Royal Rumble, what I'm thinking is we guess the winner and it's worth 2 points instead of one.
The winner of the... Okay.
Yeah. Simply because it's hard to guess and probably one of the less predictable Rumbles this year than past years.
Yeah, I agree, yeah.
Because there's so many, like Goldberg, Brock Lesnar, Undertaker's all there who could possibly win it. Samoa Joe might... He's been rumoured to be there and isn't, you know, could win it for sure. Yeah, so... Yeah, who do you think's going to win this one this year?
See, it's a very difficult one. It's a very open field.
Yes.
Could you imagine if Samoa Joe made his debut at the Royal Rumble and won it to fight AJ Styles at WrestleMania or Roman Reigns at WrestleMania?
It would be quite good, yes. It'd be bloody wonderful. It'd be so good.
I've said Taker for so long that I feel like... I mean, that's how I see this going.
Okay.
I see Taker winning the Rumble and challenging Cena for the title at WrestleMania.
Cool. I haven't given this enough thought, I've just realised. man, who do I think's going to win?
I'm only saying that because I've said it for so long that I can't, I just feel, and I've even said it on the podcast, so it's there for everyone to hear.
Yeah.
So if I go back on it now, it just sounds ridiculous. So, but I do firmly believe that that's the direction they'll go, despite the fact that they're saying otherwise.
Yeah.
Or at least rumours would suggest otherwise, but I'm having none of it. I do think Cena versus Taker, if it's going to happen, it has to happen this year. It has to.
I agree. Who do I think is going to win? Kenny Omega. No.
Do you think we'll see him?
I love it so much. I would.
What's the latest on that? Do we have any sort of Kenny Omega rumors or?
There's so many rumors. So many rumors going around, half saying yes, half saying no. So I don't even know.
Let's Google Kenny Omega. Kenny Omega talks WWE Royal Rumble rumors, Dream Match.
I think it's still less dates in Japan, so I don't know how that would work, just from like a legal standpoint.
I mean, I don't know if you've ever bought a t-shirt from Pro Wrestling Tees.
I have, actually.
I got an email from them.
Oh, yeah.
And basically it said, could Kenny Omega be going to WWE? If so, his shirts will be discontinued next week.
Oh.
So it's either a ploy to get you to buy his shirts.
Yeah.
Or, I mean, who knows? We knew at this point AJ Styles was coming in. We didn't know he was coming in at the Rumble.
Yeah, but we knew
him, Nakamura, and the club were coming to WWE. At the minute, Kenny Omega is just very much speculation.
Yeah. God, man, it'd be so good if he did.
Oh, man, it'd be awesome.
Who's thinking? Who's realistically going to win? I don't want it, but I think it's going to be someone like Brock Lesnar or Goldberg, isn't it?
I don't... But I think they're destined to fight each other, surely.
Yeah, that's true, yeah. They're going to eliminate each other. Don't think it's going to be Braun Strowman. It's definitely not going to be the Big Show.
Big Show's fighting Shaq at WrestleMania. We already know that that's not going to happen.
Yeah. It's not going to be New Day. It's not going to be...
Mojo.
I know, Mojo might win.
Could Finn Balor come back?
Could be Finn Balor.
Finn Balor take on Reigns at WrestleMania?
Ooh. That'd be good.
Could Finn Balor jump to SmackDown, maybe... fight AJ Styles at WrestleMania.
Ooh, that would be good.
I don't know if they can do that. Can they pick? Is that how it works?
I have no idea. Good question.
You know what? It's a question that WWE probably doesn't know the answer to.
Probably. They'll make it up as they go along.
Yeah, they do. Yeah, Undertaker... That's why. See, Undertaker's unregistered.
Yeah.
So if he wins, he can do whatever he wants.
Exactly.
Now, if... for example, so if Finn came back and won, he's on Raw. So automatically he's pinned against... Reigns, I guess, right?
I guess so, yeah.
This is another reason why I think Undertaker sort of... Because he can pick.
True. Well, I'm looking up the betting odds on who's going to win. Just, I'm not going to base my guess on it. I just wanna...
God, man, that's going to be ridiculous at the minute, the betting odds. Because what will be on Wednesday. Raw was on Sunday. It will definitely change between now and then.
Yeah. So right now, according to odds checker, favorite to win is Goldberg.
No.
Followed by Strowman, followed by Undertaker, followed by Randy Orton, interesting. Followed by Finn Balor, followed by Samoa Joe, followed by Chris Jericho. Brock Lesnar, both in right down the middle of them.
So basically, they don't know.
They don't know, pretty much.
Okay.
Right down the bottom, who's the least favourite to win?
Mojo.
Dana White.
Dana White?
Donald Trump, Barack Obama.
Oh, Bobby right, Rumble. Yeah, okay.
So who's actually potentially...
Imagine if Barack Obama entered the Royal Rumble.
Yeah, seriously. Out of everyone who couldn't actually be in it, Titus O'Neil's right down the bottom, just above X-Pac. and just below the Boogeyman.
Titus O'Neil's below the Boogeyman.
Yeah.
So the Boogeyman, who we've not seen in a long, long time.
Yeah.
And Titus O'Neil is on Raw every week in these god awful New Day segments.
Yeah.
Oh my good god.
Jeff Hardy, Edge is right up there for some reason with Hulk Hogan. What? Yeah, that ain't happening.
Yeah. Okay. They don't know.
They have no idea.
They have no idea at all.
Betting odds is weird.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'm going to say, look at these names again.
Saturday is the day to check betting odds, but yeah. I'm not going to, because I don't want my Raw Rumble to be spoiled. Although it could change. Yeah, I mean, we put money on WrestleMania last year, or no, not last year, year before.
Yeah.
And literally every match that we bet on, it was the opposite result.
Yeah.
Because the odds changed on the day.
Yeah.
Like, if you'd have bet on Triple H to beat Sting, on Sunday morning.
Oh yeah,
like it would have been. You'd have got so much. You'd have got money back basically. Wow. But you know, then the odds changed about a couple of hours before the show. Best person to talk about this is Steve, because I don't really know what I'm talking about. But he's got the betting thing down.
Cool.
He knows what the score is.
Yeah. So I'm going to say Finn Balor.
You're going to say Finn Balor.
Yeah. So because returning hero and all that. Finn Balor.
Okay.
And he seems healthy enough. We've seen him in interviews and whatnot, and cons, and he seems right.
I hope so. Yeah. I mean, I'd love that. I think I'd be great.
Yeah, me too. Yeah, I'd say Finn Balor. Just, yeah.
But let's just remember one thing about the Royal Rumble here.
Okay.
When was the last time you were happy with the person who won the Royal Rumble?
Daniel Bryan. Did he win it?
No.
Nope, he hasn't won it. No, I was thinking of something else.
I don't think he won it.
No, you're right, he hasn't. I was thinking of...
Reigns, right. I'm going to go down the Royal Rumbles winners if since 2010.
Okay. No, I think the other year Batista won it, didn't they? Everyone was pissed off.
Yeah. Yep.
That's what I was thinking of.
Royal Rumble winners. Right, here we go. Let's bring up the Royal Rumble winners. This has got them all the way going through it. And it's not loaded up, so that's good. Right, let's have a look here. Royal Rumble. Remember the Rumble.
Ooh.
Okay. Come on. Just give me every stat, but who's won it?
You've had Roman Reigns, Batista before that.
Del Rio. Del Rio. Sheamus.
Sheamus, yeah. God almighty. Triple H
won it last year.
Yeah, Triple H last year.
Everyone was only happy because Roman Reigns didn't win it.
Yeah.
Then the build-up to that match was just fucking god awful.
So bad.
History of Royal Rumble winners.
Cool.
This is on WWE.com. Well, I don't know why, we just don't feel like we can go to the source.
Good point.
Required cookies. This website is so bad. So bad. This website is terrible, actually.
Yeah.
Nah, fuck that. Either way, we're always disappointed with Royal Rumble winners.
Yeah. So yeah, that's the Royal Rumble. Do you want to talk about NXT TakeOver vs San Antonio?
Yes, let's.
Cool. Let's do that. So, first match I have is Roderick Strong versus Andrade Cien Almas.
Both guys need a win.
Yes.
Andrade needs a big match win.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm a big Roderick Strong fan.
Rodders.
But I'm also an ACA fan.
Mm.
Now, although I do firmly believe that ACA needs this more, I think he'll lose.
Yeah, I agree, actually. Simply because Roderick Strong hasn't been there as long and needs it more, I guess.
Yeah, it's and it seems like that is the logical way to go.
Yeah.
Because I see Roddy having a better NXT career going forward than what ACA is going to have, which is a shame because I think he's really, really good and
yep.
been even better since he's turned heel.
Agreed.
Yeah, I do see Roddy winning this one.
Yeah, me too. For sure. I like Steen Owens as well. I just say...
I don't know why he's not took off.
Yeah, it's
I don't get it.
Yeah, he's got charisma. It looks great. He's got cool moves. Everything's there. It's just something's not...
If he'd have turned up in the mask, I think everything would have been fine.
Yeah.
He's a good-looking guy. People are just so fucking jealous these days.
I guess so. But yeah, I hope everything to work out. But then we have Ty Dillinger versus Eric Young. So Eric Young invited Ty Dillinger to be part of Sanity and was denied.
Yeah.
That's the whole story.
Yeah, pretty much.
That's all we need.
I think Eric Young will win.
Okay. And do you think we'll see Ty Dillinger at the Rumble?
Maybe. It'd be awesome if he's number 10.
It would be.
It'd be perfect.
The perfect 10.
Oh, hey. Look at that. That is just impeccable teamwork.
Absolutely.
I think Eric Young will win because I think Sanity is going to have it needs the traction.
Yeah.
Ty is in a weird place, and I do think he's probably going to make a jump to the main roster, which does make me fear for Ty a little bit.
Yeah, but yeah, it's now or never for Ty, I think. Yeah, it's been NXT for a really long time, probably more than longer than anyone else is on there at the minute. And yeah, it just makes sense for him to turn up at the Rumble, I think.
Yeah.
So yeah, I'm going to say Eric Young.
They go to SmackDown.
Yeah, that makes sense. So we have hashtag DIY versus the Authors of Pain for the tag team titles.
This is a weird one.
Hmm.
Now, because the Authors of Pain haven't actually lost, have they?
I don't think so, no.
And hashtag DIY is just going to be their second title defense.
Yes.
They can't lose it just yet, surely. I mean, I mean, someone's got to beat the Authors of Pain eventually.
Mm-hmm.
It may as well be hashtag DIY because, I mean, they're awesome.
Yeah, I agree. They're the best.
Plus, I don't know about the Authors of Pain. I like them. They are dangerous, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And I just think there's potentially better matchups to be had between the likes of TM61 and hashtag DIY.
Yep.
And, you know, I mean, to be honest, they could do with a few more tag teams in NXT.
Yeah.
But, I mean, because you could have the Sanity guys, you could have Damo, who now has a different name, Killian something, White, maybe, I want to say, Killian Black, I'm not sure,
something like that, yeah.
And Tyler Fulton, is that which one he is?
Sure.
I'm not sure which one it is.
It's me either.
One got injured, didn't they?
Yeah.
Well, they're interchangeable, them two guys.
Yeah.
So they could do with a few more tag teams, but I just feel there's better potential matchups against DIY than there would be against the Authors of Pain.
Yep, I agree.
So I'm going to say DIY just for that reason.
Yeah, me too. Also, I haven't had it for very long. I don't think they're going to take one just yet because they're too good for that.
Yeah, unless they're going to make the step up, but I think the Revival will be the next ones to step up.
Yeah, I think so.
In fact, I think the fact that they don't have a match, I don't think, at TakeOver.
I think so.
Speaks volumes.
Yeah, for sure. So yeah, I think DIY is going to win, and then Authors of Pain like attack them after the match to get the heat back, whatever.
Of course, yeah.
Yeah. So then we have a Fatal 4-Way women's match. Asuka versus Billie Kay versus Paige Voice versus Nikki Cross from Sanity for the women's title.
Asuka's title reign is in a weird place.
Yes.
I like Asuka.
Me too.
But I have to be honest, I would rather them take the belt off her and give it to somebody new to help them build traction.
Hmm.
Now, no Liv Morgan in this match, no?
No.
Billie Kay and Peyton Royce both in it.
Yep.
One of them will win it.
Mm-hmm.
I think they're everywhere at the minute. They're on the WWE social media stuff.
Yep.
They're just everywhere. Whereas you've not really seen much of Asuka apart from, you know, on NXT.
Yeah, yeah.
And even then, she's not really been featured as prominently as Billie Kay and Peyton Royce.
Yep, you're right.
Nikki Cross is a bit of an afterthought. They thought, okay, we've got to have her do something.
Probably, yeah.
And I think the right thing to do would maybe have had her fight Ember Moon or someone like that on the show. But yeah, I think Billy or Peyton wins it and they do a Jericho and Owens and share the title.
Yeah, that could happen for sure.
Billy Kay is the obvious choice.
You say Billy Kay, okay.
Not the obvious choice, but the obvious choice out of the two of them to win it.
Okay, cool. I'd agree with that. I want to see Asuka versus Ember Moon. So I want to say Asuka's going to win. Okay. Just for that match. And then Ember Moon will win it for Asuka.
And then you think Asuka moves up to the main roster after that?
Probably.
Okay.
That'd be my prediction for that.
Well, okay. I'd be absolutely fine with that. I think that'd be awesome.
Yeah. But if wrestling made sense, you'd just have Peyton Royce lie down and have Billy Kay pin her and win that way.
Of course, that's exactly what would happen.
Yeah. But wrestling doesn't make sense, so it's fine. It's all good. So we have the main event, which is, of course, Shinsuke Nakamura versus Bobby.
Woo! Well, I think Nakamura wins.
Cool. Okay.
I think it's a no-brainer.
What's up when they hear Namamura? I can't type, apparently.
You wrote Namamura?
Namamura, yeah.
Shinsuke Namamura.
That's the one.
Yep, I think Nakamura wins. I'd be fine. I mean, Bobby Roode will win it down the line.
For sure.
But I don't think his time is yet, unless WWE want to build on this traction that his entrance music has built for him, and they take the title from him. But you can't have Nakamura lose it twice on recurring pay-per-views.
That's a good point, yeah. It's magic going to be excellent.
I have no doubts.
Yep. For sure.
Momentum is behind Bobby Roode, absolutely. Definitely. Has he even lost?
I don't think he has yet, no.
Has Nakamura? Of course Nakamura's lost, I just said he has. But
Yes, in the end show, yeah.
I mean, there could be a big turnaround here and Joe comes in and just ruins the match and he's not going to the main roster after all.
Yeah, maybe.
But I'd be very surprised if that's the case.
Yeah, same.
I think this match ends clean and I think Nakamura wins.
Yeah, you're right.
Are you thinking otherwise? Do you think Roode could win it?
I'm trying to think about the possibility of how Roode could win it, but
He could win it.
Yeah.
And then they could keep this program going, but I think they can anyway, even if he loses.
Yeah.
But there's good guys in NXT. I mean, I think they've fallen fairly lucky with Austin Aries getting injured.
Sure.
And the fact that they now have seen this as an opportunity to get him onto the main roster without making a big deal about it. It's now a case of, right, you've got Samoa Joe. He's lost the title, the way that the moves have gone. It now makes sense that it's his time to move up.
True.
Nakamura is carrying the brand as the champion, as the big attraction for NXT.
Yeah, seriously.
And, I mean, you could have Bobby Roode as the champion. You really could. But at the minute, I don't see it.
You know what? I wouldn't say Roode. Just, again, to be different.
I mean, I see Roderick Strong being a big player in the title picture at some point.
Yeah, probably. I wouldn't say Roode. Just on the outside chance, I think he could win it. He would definitely be a good champion. And he has a lot of momentum behind him, as you say, what with his engine music and whatnot.
The glorious thing is massive. It's so big.
It's so huge.
Yeah, okay. I mean, I can get behind it, for sure. It's just so difficult to see, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I do know what you mean. Maybe shenanigans and he's cheat somehow.
Maybe his best buddy James Storm comes and helps him.
Maybe. That'd be cool.
Surely that ship's out. I think he's still in TNA anyway.
Yeah, probably.
I'm not heartbroken that James Storm isn't in NXT.
Yeah. He was there for a little while, but then, I don't know.
He had two matches on TV.
Yeah. Strange.
He was even on Breaking Ground, even like one of Triple H's big speeches.
Oh, yeah, wasn't he? Strange. What happened to Hideo Itami? Is he injured again?
He was injured.
Yeah.
Fight in Japan? Did that not happen in the... Oh, no. Wait, did he team up with Tajiri? Or did that never happen?
He was supposed to, I think. Then I think he must have got injured again, yeah. I think that's what happened.
Did he get in... No. Wait. I can't even remember anymore.
I'll look it up.
I've lost track with Hideo Itami now.
Yeah, he hasn't been around for a long time.
Because he's there. I mean, to be honest, you just throw him on the main roster now.
Yeah, seriously.
Let him get lost on SmackDown with... Or put him in the Cruiserweight division.
Yeah, it's perfect. Injured again.
He is injured.
Yeah, looks like it. What's it say here? Hideo Itami has suffered another injury at NXT Live events, likely out of the Dusty Rhodes Classic Tag Team. Yeah, which he was. Let's have a look.
Yeah, because he missed the Dusty Rhodes Tag Team Classic, because he was due to team up with Ibushi, wasn't he?
Yeah, that was it. That would be amazing.
And then Ibushi teamed up with TJP instead.
Yeah.
But then I thought he was, because obviously they did the tour of Japan, didn't they? And that's when Nakamura beat Joe. But I thought he was supposed to be on that. I thought he was supposed to be ready for that tour.
Apparently not. WWE NXT star Hideo Itami injured his neck at a recent NXT live event and could be out for several months.
Yeah, that was when he got injured, though.
Yeah. Let's have a look. Itami's been very unlucky. Poor guy.
Oh, he's been seriously unlucky, yeah.
Doop, doop, doop.
I like him as well.
Yeah, me too. Injury update from November.
See, I think that Japan tour was in December, wasn't it?
Yeah, I think so.
So, I mean, I'm under the impression that he was supposed to be on that tour. Who did Tajiri team up with?
Let's see here. Itami was scheduled to be ready for WWE NXT live events in Japan on December 3rd.
Ah.
So him working takeover should be no-brainer. He's not worked since the NXT blah, blah, blah. So I didn't say either way.
Right. So, but the long and short of it is he's not back. Okay.
Yeah. Shame.
I don't see how he can get involved in any of these matches either. Unless he's heading straight into the main event scene and he's going to interfere in the main event.
Maybe.
But do you really see that happening?
Probably not. As much as I'd like to see Nakamura versus Itami. I don't think so.
He just needs to stay fit. He's been so unlucky. I mean, the injuries aren't, you know, that last injury especially wasn't his fault.
No.
It's nobody's fault. I mean, these things happen, of course.
Exactly, yeah.
Poor Hideo. But I'm excited for the wrestling this weekend. Really, really excited.
Me too.
Love NXT. Always love the Royal Rumble.
Yep.
Got Monday off, which is just great.
Nice.
So I'm excited for that. We will be doing both NXT and Royal Rumble streams.
Yep.
We're going to have to juggle them around.
Yeah, a little bit.
But we'll sort it.
We'll figure it out.
We will. So head over to youtube.com/sunnyfinplay and subscribe there.
Yep.
And join us for those streams whenever we manage to do them, which we will at some point.
We will.
But I think that's it for now, isn't it?
I think so.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay.
What about the book?
Of course. Finn.
Hello.
Scrambling around for the book. This week's episode of the Games and Graps podcast is brought to you by the letter.
Michael, do you use that one? Looking for letters, literally any letter. S. Looking around the room for like any letter. No, it's haven't used yet. Okay. Yes. I don't think we use S yet, have we?
I don't know. I'll find that soon. I don't think we have, though.
Cool. Okay. S. Or Sable. Or
Stacey Keebler.
Or Spike Dudley.
Is that? Oh, yeah.
Or Santina Marella. Or
Sonny Boy Hayes or Sonny King.
Yeah.
Have we done S before?
I don't remember. My memory's not working. Good. Brain no work.
Slam Master J.
Ah, okay.
Does it ring a bell?
Sort of. Read it out.
Height 5'9".
Uh-huh.
Weight 210 pounds, from the ATL. Representing the ATL, or Atlanta to most people, Slam Master J spent the majority of his brief SmackDown career trying to impress Crime Time. Hoping we'd get to roll with JTD and Shad, Slam Master set out on a crusade to prove he was street tough.
We haven't seen this before, no.
His antics including vandalising Theodore Long's office, stealing DVDs, and generally speaking in an urban vernacular incomprehensible by anybody with an earshot. Jesus.
Yep.
Sporting a skull cap and oversized jeans, of course.
Of course.
Slam Master J made his SmackDown in-ring debut against Charlie Haas in the summer of 2009, where he picked up an impressive win over the former tag team champ, but was unable to keep the momentum going, as he followed up the victory with disappointing performances against Dolph Ziggler and Kane.
Yeah.
Why is he even taking on these people?
I don't know.
Hoping his family history of success in tag team competition would rub off, his father is Terry Gordy of the Fabulous Freebirds.
Ah.
Slam Master performed a partnership with Jimmy Wang Yang in late 2009. The odd pairing, however, failed to mirror the Freebird's success. Slam Master J was gone from WWE soon after.
Oh, right. I have no memory of him whatsoever.
If Slam Master J is Jesse from Jesse and Festus.
Oh, really?
I can't tell.
You know what? Now that you've said that, it kind of rings a bell. Let's have a look.
Well, it looks like him.
Yeah.
And by the way, Terry Gordy must be so proud of Slam Master J.
Yeah, seriously. Slam Master J. Ray Gordy. Let's have a look. Best neighbor's appearances by Buzz Entertainment. On SmackDown brand at the rings. Jesse and Slam Master J. Yeah.
He was him. Jesse.
Yeah.
I love how WWE think people are fucking stupid.
Yeah.
Hey, remember Jesse? Yep, well, now you don't. He's now Slam Master. Oh, wait, Jay.
Huh?
Jay. Slam Master Jay.
Yeah, have his heads.
So, was he still Jesse, or?
I guess so. Slam Master Jesse.
Cuck.
Yeah. He appeared the same year he appeared on as Jesse as well.
Yeah. Not even time off, just like, put a baseball cap and a vest on. Skip Sheffield is here. Obviously, that's Ryback.
Yep.
In pants, in bold.
Yep, pretty much.
Who else we got? Simon Dean. Oh, that's a bad one.
Simon Dean.
That is a bad one. Do you remember Simon Dean?
I don't.
Fitness instructor Simon Dean?
Maybe.
He used to be Nova in ECW.
Oh.
And then he came to WWE and was Simon Dean, and it is so bad.
God.
What else we got in here? Of course, we've got our favourite wrestler.
Oh, yes.
The Ultimate Fighter.
Yeah.
Sin Cara.
Woo.
Who hasn't been seen for a long time.
Yeah, where's he been?
Sim Snooker. Now, is this another fake sibling? Like we had last week, didn't we? We had one of the Funks who wasn't one of the Funks, but WWE said they were.
Yeah.
Now, it's Snooker, obviously, you don't use that name.
Yeah.
Flippantly.
Let's have a look. With Sim, S-I-M.
With decades of sports entertainment history flowing through his veins, Snooker yearned to join forces with other multi-generational superstars. Well, according to this...
Oh, it's Deuce from Deuce and Domino.
Oh, yeah, it does say that, actually. Following a successful run with partner Domino, Deuce was shipped to Raw. Upon arrival, revealed that he was the son of WWE Hall of Famer Jimmy Superfly Snooker.
I guess it is his son, then, I guess. Yeah, it is, according to Wikipedia.
Really?
Yeah. Jimmy Snooker's his dad. Tamina's his sister.
I have to be honest, I'm shocked.
Yeah, me too. Interesting.
Wrestling here called Sir Oliver Humperdinck.
Ooh.
But you can't mess with the old school. So.
Cool name.
When's Shelton Benjamin?
He got injured.
I know he got injured, but like, do we ever expect to see him? Because I know that was the original plan, right?
Hey, no, it's that meat. No. I hope so. I like Shelton Benjamin.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah.
Sherry Martel, superb manager.
Yeah, excellent.
Never heard of Shawn Michaels.
No, who's he? Shane McMahon. McHoo. McWhat now?
I used to love Sergeant Slaughter.
Yeah. Maggots.
Shaniqua. That's a stripper name if ever I've heard one.
Yeah, seriously. Shaniqua.
Shane Douglas. Man. You know what? Such a waste.
Yeah.
Scotty Goldman.
Ooh.
Otherwise known as Colt Cabana.
Oh, yeah. He was there for 5 minutes.
Yeah. Serena, remember her?
Oh yes,
from the Straight Edge Society.
Yeah, yeah, one of the best gimmicks that never was. The last of like, yeah. Better on SmackDown and
SD Special Delivery Jones.
Oh god,
that's my kind of wrestling. Sean O'Hare, rest in peace. God. Scott Stanford, is he still there?
I don't know. I haven't seen him in a long time. We got NXT for a while.
Salvatore Sincere, Salvatore Belermo. So, there's some crap in here. Wow.
Wow. Don't know what it is.
Ryan Braddock.
Ooh.
Never heard of him.
Now into the R's.
Rue de Bono. Now I do recognise that name.
Ooh.
Rue de Bono. I think she was like Tucker or something.
Yeah.
Oh no, wait. She's the co-host of Afterburn. Anyway, we're literally just sort of going through the S's here. And,
pretty much.
This week's episode of the Games and Grabs podcast was brought to you by the letter S.
Yeah. Oh, by the way, I remember how last week JBL tripped on some wires. On 205 Live, there's a wrestler, a jobber wrestler named Trip Bradshaw.
Seriously?
Yeah, yeah.
Do we think it's connected?
Of course, it's got to be, surely.
It has to be, right?
Yeah, it's got to be.
Trip Bradshaw.
Yeah.
I bet Vince McMahon was creasing.
Yeah, it's got to be.
Boys and girls, this has been the Games and Grats podcast. We are Daydreamer Gaming's weekly video game and wrestling podcast that posts every single Friday.
Yes.
Across podcast services, everywhere.
Everywhere.
Go subscribe to Sonny and Finplay on YouTube, which is youtube.com/ Sonny and Finplay.
Yep.
Go subscribe to Daydreamer Gaming on YouTube. We don't have our own URL yet, but if you type in Daydreamer Gaming, you will find us.
Yep.
We'll get in there.
We'll get there.
Go subscribe to the podcast on iTunes. Follow us on SoundCloud, and you can listen to the podcast on pretty much any other podcast service.
Yep.
Can we look at getting it on Spotify?
I'll try.
Sure. If you want to win a copy of Resident Evil 7, you head over to Daydreamer Gaming on YouTube, subscribe, and you could be within a chance of winning. Mm. Of course, if you're listening to this after the 29th of January, your time has passed. If you're listening to it before, good luck.
Care for it.
But for now, this has been episode 49 of the Games and Grats podcast. We'll be back with a big 5-0 next week.
Yay.
I'm Sonny.
I'm Finn.
And we will speak to you next time. Goodbye.
Thank you very much. Goodbye.
Divas.